quickly tell you how it's going to run. So I'm just going to start off and try and be fairly brief. Then Babette, Tracy's wife, will say some words, and then Jonathan will kind of sort of wrap up the kind of quasi-formal bit of the proceedings, at which point we move to comfy chairs. Because there's tea and coffee and milk and stuff, and we just have to make it ourselves. But and then we can sit in comfy chairs and chat and remember. So I first came across Tracy when I was writing my PhD by reading his book Friedrich Nietzsche and the Politics of Transfiguration. Which was the first major work on Nietzsche as a political thinker and remains the best, has kind of achieved a status of sort of minor classic in the field. So when I finished my PhD, I wrote Tracy a letter because this was in the days before email was invented. Okay, so this is about 1990. And I wrote this letter with no great expectation of receiving a reply. After all, here is this sort of, you know, young British nobody, and here is Tracy, who was already a full professor at UCSD. So about 2 months later, to my shock and delight, I got this long letter back from Tracy exploring our, you know, agreements and disagreements on things Nietzsche, and, you know, reminding me to look him up if I came to the States. So some years later, email happened, at which point we kind of stopped writing occasional letters to one another and started having kind of more sort of, I guess, more rapid conversations where it didn't take a month or two for each bit of the conversation to work. And then in 99, when I was on sabbatical from here, I went down to UCSD to give a talk and spend a few days with Tracy, enjoying some excellent cooking and becoming friends, essentially, in the way that you do. So when Tracy was retiring from UCSD and looking to move back to Europe, and that coincided with our having a, you know, possible chair in political theory, I mean, I mentioned it to him again, thinking, you know, this would not be perhaps something to be interested in, but he was, and he came, and for me and for some others, at least, and perhaps many others, having him here was a gift. So I could go on and on about my relationship with Tracy, but I don't want to do that. Instead, I'm going to read you some words from Monique, who couldn't be here today because her twins have a performance that, as a single mother, she has to go to. So here's Monique. Tracy had beautiful eyes. When he spoke about subjects that interested him, his eyes would sparkle with excitement. Many years ago, after I gave my first seminar talk at the department, about my research on semiconductors, he came to me speaking with his eyes sparked by excitement. I saw the appreciation in his eyes and felt grateful for his kindness. On numerous occasions, I was very lucky to have felt cared for by his soft-heartedness and compassion. In many ways, he was like a father figure to me, always ready to reach out to me when I needed guidance and assistance. I also enjoyed many of our conversations about his legendary great aunt, Anna Louise, for anyone who doesn't know, Anna Louise Strong, radical American journalist, taught Trotsky English, close friends with Mao Zedong and many other Chinese leadership buried in the Beijing Martyrs graveyard in Beijing. His great aunt Anna Louise, his family connections to China, his 1985 encounter with Deng Xiaoping, his attendance in China of a conference about the Long March, and his 2015 presence at the Grand Parade in front of the Tiananmen Square to mark the 70th anniversary of the Chinese defeat of the Japanese. Tracy, as you may know, was born in a Japanese prisoner of war camp as his parents were missionaries in China. Tracy also shared with me his passion for research, cooking and family. During our long chats 1 week before his passing, he passionately told me once again about what a great chef he is, especially in making Chinese dumplings, and how his son and daughter differed in their personality, but how proud he was of them. In turn, I shared with him my passion for writing my next research monograph about problematic sovereignty, and my eagerness to cook for him and his wife some nice Taiwanese food. We agreed we would meet up in the early summer. Despite Tracy's sad passing, I want to remember his beautiful eyes and his extreme kindness and compassion. Most of all, I want to be like him, a lofty figure in his area of expertise, with humility and good-heartedness. I will miss him deeply. That's from Monique. So at this point, I'm going to pass to Babette, Tracy's wife, to say a few words.
Trying to use technology, and technology hates me, which is normal. Mm-hmm. So I have backups because I'm used to that. It was a memorial, and I'm recording this for the family who are not here, so that they can be here virtually. And I'm grateful to them, especially his daughter and niece, who organized also the manner of speaking, etc., at the memorial. And I noted when I spoke there the care of his sister and his brother, and the fact that Tracy really liked being the oldest. That was very important. He was quintessentially the oldest child, and I would know. I am one myself, six younger than me, but he had me beat for gravitas and joy. He loved. It's hard to accept, it was a shocking passing, that anyone larger than life might die, that anyone so passionately devoted to life in all its aspects, its delights and its trials, glorious and messy, poetic and wondrous, might die. I pick up on one of Tracy's students, who now teaches at the University of Southern California, at UCSD, a grad student, who wrote, rightly, just three words, "Tracy is poetry." And that is the pain of this, the beauty, it is beauty, of mortality. Tracy's favorite word, and I think concept, theologically speaking, in German, was eingefleisch. And the flesh, all of it so much grass, is what is lost. As Wendy Brown mentioned in her message of condolence, rereading Tracy and David Owen's introduction to Weber's vocation lectures, Tracy corresponded with her just a little before he died, Tracy had a subtle and imaginative way, she wrote, with some of the most unsubtle things and thinkers. Tracy co-edited a collection on ethical pluralism with Richard Matson and another with the late Marcel Enaf, Public Space and Democracy, in addition to his collection with Michael Gillespie, Nietzsche's New Seas. He was also the co-author of articles, generous as he was, with his students. I knew Tracy first, just like David. I'm going to steal it, but it's I have it too. Might be, I argue, the best way to meet any scholar by reading his first book, which I read in the spring, I'm much older than David, of 1980, or maybe summer 81, specifically Friedrich Nietzsche and the Politics of Transfiguration, which was the first book I ever read, to which I did not keep a muttering, running commentary. No, no, no. I didn't agree with everything, but I didn't not agree either. Our conversation began then. About a decade later in Washington, D.C., end of summer 1993, I attended an APSA meeting with my colleague, Nicole Fermont. Reading the program, I recognized Tracy's name. I didn't know philosopher, I didn't know any political theorist. Nah, Nicole said, she was very uncompromising, he's not worthwhile. He's all washed up. Tracy had just turned 50. I still wanted to hear him speak. It was not, I have to say, love at first sight, but I saw, actually thought, he's not dead. That's what I thought. It's my head. He jumped up and down while speaking. Tracy told me he saw me immediately and was taken when I asked a question. Some years later, we did fall in love, and falling is very much the word for it. Tracy started it. Of course he started it. He had a lot of practice, but the force was undeniable. A shock of wings slamming down on the mind, no helping anything. And now, incarnate wings broken and with new wings of spirit, Tracy, who told us how to write scripture and reflected on love and the world's need for love, belongs to the angels. I ended my comments on Saturday, I just read them to you, right there, and some wrote to complain. And Tracy would have said that it would have been better to finish, which I tend not to do, because I figured people have had enough of that. But this is his life, so I'm going to say a little more. Late marriages, ours was a late marriage, happen for reasons of urgency. Rather, as early marriages tend to happen, there were worries. I had a companion I was in love with. We were engaged. Plus, Tracy's wife had just died, and Tracy's family would have much preferred that he wait, but that was not Tracy. This means there was offense given all around, but Tracy would say, he said this repeatedly, that his relationship to me was the most important in his life. If ours was not a love story of a conventional kind, it was both a philosophical companionship and a journey through the closing decades of Tracy's life, which, because he was Tracy, also reviewed in conversation and reflection the entirety of his life. He told me everything, again and again. The things Tracy thought important were the things he wrote about. This is a point Alastair MacIntyre made when he sent me his condolences, as he had known Tracy throughout his own time stateside, making, quite as Alastair did, the reverse migration from Manchester, where he initially was, he was Wolf May's assistant, to Boston. Condolences sent from Quentin Skinner echo Tracy's irrepressible tendency toward controversiality, as Skinner put it, along with his generosity to his interlocutors. That extreme generosity, that's a quote, was emphasized by Jeff Waite. We never figured a way to live together. I am simply, and I did warn him about this, the wrong kind of philosopher for UCSD. The department never considered hiring me, and likewise Southampton, given the folks in the department here, though they did Tracy the favor once, I think, through the political science department, of interviewing me at Winchester, some collective thing, and were duly horrified. And that was that. Later, another department more proper to the University of Winchester gave me an honorary, nota bene, not a real, appointment. Strangely, and I thought them mad on the East Coast, I couldn't get Fordham to hire Tracy. I tried. And Columbia had their reasons. Tracy said he had enemies, so too NYU and the New School, and so too Princeton. And he nearly got a post at Rutgers, but then Carrie McWilliams died, and that was that. Tracy was, I think, everything singular and crucial in indispensable ways to so many friends and students that it's breathtaking and a loss for the whole of political theory, as everyone here knows better than I ever might. Tracy told me of his regret, and that led to a faux pas on my part in recent weeks, and I really regret that, because in grief, I rebuked, and I should not have done that, a colleague he had complained about for the last couple of months, years actually, for the fact of delaying publication of his work, as such details of publishing mattered immensely to him. I think he took the laugh very seriously. His longer-running quiet complaint was that no one had collated, and maybe that's going to change, a festschrift in his honour, which was an injustice given everything he gave. It is not as if people were unaware of what Tracy brought to the table. They were, I think, very aware. But it was simply assumed, as I assumed his being, his their being, as Heidegger would say, his way of presence as a constant, a gift. But that also means as a gift. It was Tracy who always said, death comes, whenever it comes, outside the frame. Here, that is the shock, the suddenness of his death, of all the many things he suffered from, Tracy died of none of them. It was not the cancer that killed him, he didn't have COVID, and it wasn't his asthma. But there is another frame, that of gathered friendship. Thus, if Tracy's friends did not as such become my friends, David Owen is an exception, but David is always an exception, and we were friends, David and I, at least in my mind beforehand, each and every one of my friends became our friends for real. Absolutely, not a matter of toleration, this is the new person, but intimacy, visiting in some cases our home, vacationing with us for weeks at a time, arguing and debating with us, living the vital life of the mind. And Tracy would say this as each friend in turn died. David Allison, my teacher as an undergrad, to whom I first cited Tracy's work, as well as Patrick Aidan Heelan and Bill Richardson, a Heidegger expert. The last two were Jesuits who married us in a con-celebrated mass with Father Leo O'Donovan, who had just then retired as president of Georgetown University back in the fall 2001 at the Church of St. Ignatius of Loyola on Park Avenue in New York City. And again, Dick Cobb Stevens, a Husserlian, wrote on Husserl and analytic philosophy, where it was once again Tracy who would be the best interlocutor on the poet Wallace Stevens and on Merleau-Ponty for a commemorative essay I wrote. I've already referred, this eulogy has a title, it's written obviously, Right in His Soul, saying that it was inspired by the biography he co-authored with Helene Kaysar, his late wife, on his great aunt, you can see it there, Right in Her Soul. I made it Right in His Soul. My reason, however, was akin to the claim that led Adam Smith to argue that the notorious atheist, Tracy wasn't, his friend David Hume, Adam Smith's friend, was, I quote, good. Now, although Tracy mentions Hume in The Idea of Political Theory, The Connection, and other, actually, one of the first books he writes on the self, the connection seems tenuous. But Hume made it his business to write a last book, Five Dissertations, a title which, if you're not a Hume scholar, you may never have heard of, as his final salvo among his many essays, including The Natural History of Religion, Of the Passions, Of Tragedy, Of Suicide, and for good measure, Of the Immortality of the Soul. William Warburton was, as Nigel Warburton, the exponent of philosophy bites, tells me, one of his ancestors, Nigel's ancestors, threatened Hume with excommunication and other damages should the book be published as printed. Read that again, that sentence. It's plain that the book had already been printed. What to do? Now, Andrew Millar, Hume's printer, there's a recent piece on Millar in the LRB, could ill afford such a consequence financially and otherwise, and so Hume did what authors faced with censorship or just a nasty reviewer number two do in such circumstances. He cut the offending essays and wrote an essay to fit of the standard of taste. Now, I know this because I edited a collection on this and I worried the topic. Maybe you can tell. Adam Smith's defense of Hume was that he was reading Lucian. Smith's point was theologically complex, and it's what justifies my title, Right in His Soul. Hanging on to life wasn't the point. Immortality, also not the point. Instead, one ought to meet death, as Lucian argued, as the shoemaker who comes running up, and this Tracy would have appreciated, he hated being late to things, to catch other conventionally mournful souls who didn't want to leave, to board the bark leaving port. Tracy was, to my mind, this running, laughing man. And he was good. So Smith argued, Hume said he had the same reason not to remain attached to life, because his one concern was the fate of his writings. Like Hume, the parallel, and that was part of McIntyre's confidence when he wrote to me, was concerned for the things he wrote. And I hold a candle for the hope that someone will collate a festschrift in his honour, on his thinking, on a lifetime of thought. Tracy never urged this to his friends, as he was also possessed of an indomitable reticence. He was shy. Who could tell? Almost as if he was a little autistic, very odd. One of the reasons he was such a good listener. The one book I hoped Tracy would write, and he didn't, was an autobiography, as only he could write it, a witness to his more than three quarters of a century of watching politics in the world. It's an autobiography that is what we need right now, given Tracy's voice. There's a bit of that in his most personal book on Rousseau. Go read it if you have not. It would have been his eyes, his witness, his incarnation, as he favored that mystery of incarnation, the body and its enjoyments, its limitations and its pains, as that made all the difference. I will miss him. Tracy made everything.
The first time I encountered Tracy, we actually did not meet in person. I was attending the International Studies Association in San Diego in 2006. I was a newly minted PhD student, and as one does at that stage of one's career, I crammed into a hotel room with three of my fellow Minnesota PhD students, trying to make the trip more affordable. One of my roommates was working on a thesis on sovereignty and was reading Carl Schmitt's Political Theology. So for those who don't know, Tracy wrote the introduction to the English translation, and it's probably the most influential treatment of Schmitt's political work in the English language. So my roommate Mark was very absent-minded. And so he managed, within the first day of the conference, to misplace his copy of the Schmitt book, and he was quite distraught by this. Later that evening, I was at a reception, looked down at a table, and saw a well-thumbed copy of Carl Schmitt's Political Theology. I flipped it open, and on the front page was scrawled, "Warmest regards, Tracy B. Strong." I handed it back to Mark, asking, "Is this your copy?" And he said, "I think so, but I've never met Professor Strong, so how could he have autographed it?" We decided to take it, and I persuaded a somewhat nervous Mark to email Professor Strong. The worst that could happen is he'd think we were a pair of crazy grad students. So Mark did, explaining the situation, and hesitatingly inquired if Tracy had found the book and autographed it. A somewhat cryptic and brief email, a style to which I would become accustomed years later at Southampton, replied, "Indeed, 'twas I." Years later, when I was his colleague at Southampton, I'd learned that this combination of the playful with the deeply scholarly was very much the Tracy Strong style. I was fortunate enough to co-teach our undergraduate political theory modules with him for several years. So normally when one co-teaches, we divide the lectures in half and you only show up to deliver your own lectures. Tracy thought this was a bad idea and insisted we teach together and that the other would always be present at the lectures when not lecturing. So this ended up being a treat for me. I got to see some of his classic undergraduate lectures. He has a fantastic one that spends the whole 45 minutes analyzing the frontispiece of Hobbes's Leviathan, and a lecture that focuses entirely on Nietzsche's style, and a third that plays excerpts of music by Wagner trying to tie it back into Nietzsche's aesthetics, and a very complicated lecture I still don't think I fully understand on the mathematics of Rousseau's general will. And so even though this was all material that I had taught for many years before teaching with Tracy, he had a capacity to show me new things in very familiar passages, in very familiar texts. We also developed a bit of our own style together. And I'm not sure what the students ever made of it, but when I would lecture, Tracy would sit on a stool, basically just about over there, off to the side, almost acting like my hype man. So I'd make a point, and Tracy would suddenly interject, "That's right," and then he'd perhaps add an example. So as an example of this, I have a lecture on how Thucydides constructs the Peloponnesian War. So the point being that in the book, the events Thucydides ties together may not have been seen as a single event by his contemporaries. And part of what Thucydides is trying to do is to tie these disparate events together into a coherent narrative, offering a new interpretation to his readers of what is happening. And I know that students sometimes miss this point. They find it confusing. And so I remember one day a student asking skeptically about what the ancient Greeks would have thought the war was then. And then Tracy stood up and went, when did World War II start? He's pointed right at the student. And the answer came back, September 1939, after the Germans invaded Poland. And he went, Tracy went, you see, if I ask that question in America, every student there will say December 7th, 1941, with the attack on Pearl Harbor. And I ask it, if I ask it in China, they'll say 1931, with the Japanese invasion of Manchuria. And if I ask it in Russia, they will say June 1941, with the German invasion. His point here, and this is a point that runs through his scholarship, is there are no facts independent of our interpretation of those facts. It's a point that he returned to in his work, in his teaching, sometimes to frustration of some of my colleagues, occasionally in departmental meetings too. And it's a theme that runs through Tracy's work from beginning to end. So I'm not sure what the students made of all this, perhaps sometimes baffled, hopefully sometimes inspired, sometimes perhaps slightly horrified. Always, though, I believe learning. I remember another lecture that Tracy gave on Nietzsche, explained the significance of the Apollonian and Dionysian spirits. That day he showed up to class, revisiting the spirit of 1968, with an American flag bandana wrapped around his head. And he'd lecture for a bit, unpacking a passage in Nietzsche, and then he'd pause, looking for an example to explain it. And he'd go, you know, it's like being at a rock concert. Who here goes to concerts? And he's teaching to a very reserved, you know, South of England audience. The students there were reticent to express anything. So no response. So slightly baffled, he carries on, talking about lecture Nietzsche for a bit more. And then a few minutes later, he pauses. It's a bit like taking a really strong drug. Who here's ever had a trip on pot or acid? Again, horrified silence. Carries on for a bit more, completely exasperated, and goes, it's a bit like completely losing yourself in the ecstasy of sex. Who here has had sex? A bunch of horrified gasps from the students. And Tracy is completely confused at this point. He just goes, you don't go to concerts, you don't take drugs, you don't have sex. What do you do? I learned just as much from Tracy's scholarship as I did from our time together in the classroom. So we shared a love of the philosophy of Stanley Cavell, and Tracy very kindly read through my whole manuscript in about a week, offering feedback and correcting some very glaring errors. While Tracy did not publish much work that was explicitly about Cavell, the influence of Cavell's thought runs throughout his work. And I think this comes across most clearly in what I consider to be his magnum opus, Politics Without Vision. So the title alludes to Sheldon Wolin's foundational political theory text, Politics and Vision, which reconstructed Western political thought from the ancients to the moderns as a series of visions of new political order. So on Wolin's account, the epic political theorist writes in response to the crises of their time. So we can think here of Hobbes writing in the wake of the English Civil War and offering a new vision of political order that shapes the subsequent era. Tracy's book wrote a history of 20th century political thought, but contra Wolin. And in the wake of what Tracy concluded was, and this is a direct quote from him, the morally worst century in human history. There was no vision that a theorist could offer us. This puts us in a precarious position here. Individually, we have to think for ourselves. And the subtitle of his book picks up on this theme, Thinking Without a Banister in the 20th Century. This alludes to Arendt's phrase of thinking without recourse to pre-existing authority structures. So things that in the past would have served such as God or transcendental philosophy that was common in the modern era or the received dogmas of the great ideologies of the early 20th century. The 20th century, through its wars and atrocities, but also through the rise of mass communication, the democratization of institutions, destroyed every foundation upon which one could reasonably claim to know truth with certainty. Tracy's book explores this crisis in authority across the writings of 8 highly complex and diverse thinkers, weaving these interpretations into a coherent whole. So central to the book is Tracy's claim, in a move partly inspired by Cavell, that given the collapse in these authority structures, we no longer have any external sources that can guide our thought. We must think for ourselves. But what does this thinking for ourselves entail? How do we go about it? Tracy's great insight in this book and across his work was that in order to think without banisters, we must shift our focus from the epistemological questions to the aesthetic ones. And by this he meant not merely approaching the world like an artist seeking to capture its beauty, rather than the scientist seeking to explain its causal mechanisms, though he certainly did mean that. But more significantly, he meant, I'm quoting directly from him here, the acknowledgement of the presence of the incomprehensible and the consequent recognition that what one says about it is necessarily in and only in one's own voice. End the quote. Tracy was thinking deeply and originally then about post-truth politics and its consequences long before the world had ever heard of Donald Trump. So I wish to close here with a brief passage from one of Tracy's favorite poets, Wallace Stevens. And out of what one sees and hears, and out of what one feels, who could have thought to make so many selves, so many sensuous worlds, as if the air, the midday air, was swarming with the metaphysical changes that occur merely in living as and where we live.
Right, now, if this were truly an appropriate or fully appropriate celebration for Tracy, we would now have several bottles of red wine open. But because we're not allowed to do that here, we can move down into the next room and sort of make tea and coffee. And then I think a little later, some of us will probably go to the pub for a glass of red wine. But anyway, thank you all for coming to celebrate and remember Tracy. And you've been standing up for quite a while now. So let's move to the comfy chairs.